Hello Internet! Did you ever wonder how tides work? To answer this question, we need to consider two theories. The equilibrium theory will give us a basic understanding of tidal forces. Meanwhile, the dynamic theory explains the visible tides of our oceans. Since both are important and the second depends on the first, let's start with the basics. But let's begin by making things a little easier. Let's assume that our planet does not have any land masses. Also, we need to cover our planet with a unified deep ocean, so we won't need to consider the ocean floor. Okay, let's get started. First, we have to take a look at gravity. In short, gravity is a force that pulls objects towards each other. This force acts even over long distances, but rapidly grows weaker. Because of this weakening effect, the only celestial bodies to consider are the Sun and our Moon. Even though the Sun is simply huge, our Moon is very close to Earth. Because of that, the tidal forces of our Moon are twice as strong as those of the Sun. Or in other words, our Sun is so far away that its tidal forces only account for 46% of the Moon's influence. So for further simplification, let's just ignore the Sun. For now. Our Moon is the greater influence and their forces work in exactly the same way. Now to the explanation. First, let us place some points. A. For the ocean facing the Moon. B. Our Earth itself. And C. The ocean facing away from the Moon. Every point is attracted or accelerated towards the Moon through its gravity. But since gravity becomes weaker over distance, we need to shorten those arrows accordingly. If we now move every point to its arrowhead, you can see how the water starts accumulating on each side of Earth. These are the tidal bulges, and Earth rotates beneath them every 24 hours. In contrast, our Moon, the cause of these walls of water, needs about 28 days to orbit the Earth once. This results in almost stationary bulges. But let's put ourselves on Earth. We are standing right inside one bulge. So, now we are in high tide. After 6 hours, we'll rotate into low tide, and after another 6 hours, we'll be in high tide again. Then low tide, followed by another high tide. Well, almost. We assume that our Moon is fixed in the sky, but in reality, it does move a little bit. So, Earth needs to rotate about 50 minutes longer before we'll be underneath the Moon again. This explains why there is a daily 1-hour shift in the timetable of the tides. Next, we get to weak and strong tides, the so-called neap and spring tides. For those, we need the Sun. As mentioned before, the Sun is about half as strong as our Moon. If the Sun, Earth and the Moon are aligned, their tidal forces combine to form spring tides. It doesn't matter which side the Moon is on, because the opposite side of Earth is also affected. If the Moon now moves to an angle of 90 degrees, the forces of the Sun and the Moon start to interfere and weaken each other. The result are smaller neap tides. And there we have it. High tide, low tide, spring and neap tide. So is that it? Well, not quite. This was just the usual explanation, which has a few problems, such as no land masses. But I, for my part, rather like some solid ground beneath my feet. So let's take a short look at the land. According to our model, the Moon raises the water. But if this were the case, there would be the same tides in the Mediterranean as there are in the North Sea. So what's going on? Let's start with this. In our model, we only observed 3 points. Yet, the pulling forces work on every point on Earth. So let's fill in some arrows to show the direction and strength of gravity. We've also ignored an important value, the centrifugal force. For this, we have to draw even more arrows. The rule is simple, all are facing away from the Moon and have the same strength. For those who want to know why, here we go. These forces occur because the Moon does not really rotate around Earth. Instead, Earth and the Moon orbit within 28 days around their common center of mass, the so-called barycenter. Think of it like this. We've got two teams in a tug of war. In the middle of the rope there is a flag. This represents our center of mass. As long as both teams are of the same size or mass, the flag stays in the middle, but as soon as one team loses a member, the flag moves toward the larger team. The greater the difference, the greater the outcome. Earth's mass is fairly larger than the Moon's, so the shared barycenter still lies within Earth. But since our Moon is relatively large, it pulls the barycenter about 2/3 of the Earth's radius away from its core. This forces our planet to rotate together with the Moon around their joint barycenter, completely independent from the rotation around their own axis. As you can see, this movement creates the centrifugal force we've seen earlier. All arrows point away from the Moon and are of the same strength. So let's go back to our model. We have now marked every point with its gravitational pull and the centrifugal force. If we combine the two arrows, we will get the actual direction and intensity of the acting force. After doing that to every point on Earth, it should look like this. Seems familiar. just like the model of the two water bulges. Yet, we raise no water, but we will deform the entire Earth according to those arrows. Now we have squeezed our Earth together. So far, nothing has really happened to the oceans. They are still as deep as before, but we have to consider that water is somewhat more flexible than solid rock. Thus, it can flow towards the gravitational bulges. And now we have our water bulges again. They weren't lifted, just relocated. What we can do now is explain the Mediterranean Sea. In itself, it is not large enough to produce visible tides, so it depends on water from the oceans. Yet, the only way for water to enter the Mediterranean is the Strait of Gibraltar. But this passage is not wide enough to really make a difference. That's why you won't see any tides in the Mediterranean. And with this, we complete the equilibrium theory. We now know the basic tidal effect on celestial bodies, which are also responsible for Saturn's rings. But I have some bad news. This theory won't get us anywhere to explain the visible ocean tides. But didn't we just explain the Mediterranean? Well, kind of, but not really. You see, if this were the explanation for the ocean tides, every coast in this whole region would have high tide. That's not what's happening in reality. I took two cities in the Netherlands as an example, Den Helder and Harlingen. With the sea between them, they are only about 50 kilometers or 31 miles apart. But when Harlingen has low tide, we have high tide in Den Helder. And throughout the time high tide is arriving in Harlingen, the high tide stays in Den Helder. To explain this phenomenon, we need to look into the dynamic theory. But this will be the topic of the next video. What did you ever wonder about? Write it in the comments and your idea could be the topic of a future video. If you like this video and want to help out my channel a little, why don't you leave a thumbs up? You can even hit that subscribe button to be notified when the next video will come out. In the meantime, thanks for watching. Have a good one.